Welcome, 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 everyone. It is Friday. It is 10 a.m., and if it's Friday, 10 a.m., you know it's WMNF. This is Down and Dirty with Mario Nunez today. Sitting in for John Dingfelder is, of course, our favorite co-host, Joe Howden, also known as Joe King Carter. How you doing this morning, Joe?
Hey, brother, I am just outstanding.
You know, you look
stunning.
Good. You look good. You look fabulous.
Thank you.
Got up early this morning, did your hair and your makeup. But it's radio, Joe.
Hairs.
It's radio.
Hairs.
All right. Well, listen, how was, it's been an eventful week.
It has been an eventful week.
It started out Monday with a solar eclipse that, of course, you know, everybody, I know people that traveled to be in the track of totality. Now we have another term that we have to deal with. There's track of totality to go along with cone of uncertainty. Can you help me, please? I don't know what's going on.
Yeah, well, you know, we've ordered our society by the appearances of objects in the sky forever, and so it makes sense that it was a big deal and a big event. I briefly went outside and said, I see no difference, and then I went back in. But
I will say this, though, and kudos to those people that actually took it upon themselves to travel to destinations, some as far as Austin, Texas, to be in the path, because apparently it was such a moving experience, and I would like to, before the curtain comes down finally, to experience it for myself, because it, you know, by all accounts, everybody said it was moving and breathtaking and in some ways energy shifting and things of that ilk. So I think it as humans on this journey, it would probably behoove us at some point to be in the track of totality, to experience that. Because, you know, the light goes completely dark.
Yes.
The birds start to do weird things. The animals don't know what's freaking out.
Yes.
The temperature changes. I mean, there are certain things that just happen, physiological changes, magnetic changes, I'm sure.
A profound moment, I'm sure, for anybody who experiences it. I've not experienced it either.
Nor have I.
Let me say that there's also another event this week.
Okay.
And that event is that I believe that you experienced a milestone and got some attention for that.
Milestone, not to be confused with gallstone, kidney stone, or Diana stone. I'm just going to say it's Diane Stone,
right.
Diane Stone,
yeah.
Not Diana. Thank you for mentioning that, Joe. So there were two actually this week. On Wednesday, April the 10th, my parents celebrated their 76th wedding anniversary.
Amazing.
Which I tell everybody, when you see them, take a picture, man. Because if you saw a Triceratops or a Brontosaurus walking down MLK, you would immediately whip out that phone
and
start taking a lot of pictures, if not video.
Yeah.
So take a picture of these two wonderful people, because you're never going to see that again.
Do you happen to know what percentile of Americans are married that long?
The best the Census Bureau can guesstimate is that they may be one of 1,000 couples to reach it to make it to 75.
Wow.
We know that Jimmy Carter and Rosalind Carter, rest in peace, made it to 77.
Cousin Jimmy.
There you go.
That's right.
So, I'm you know, my mission now in life is to keep them around to get to 77, because my dad has said he wants to be in the same conversation with Jimmy Carter.
Yeah.
The other thing that took place on Wednesday, and this, I'm glad you mentioned this. Thank you for bringing it up, Joe. I celebrated a milestone, and that was that I walked into One Blood Florida, you know, Florida's Blood Services, and they're actually all throughout the southeastern United States. For those that don't know, One Blood is in Alabama and Georgia and South Carolina, Florida certainly, and donated a pint of blood, which I've been doing since I was 18 years old. 47 years later, it took me a minute, but I got to the 20-gallon threshold. So I'm going to ring a bell for myself, and I'm going to remind everybody that if you're well and healthy enough, walk into your local blood donation center and consider donating it. It not only makes you feel good, it does. There are healthful benefits for you personally.
Absolutely.
But you're helping others. My blood type is O negative. And you know what? Do you know what your blood type is?
Absolutely.
Joe?
I'm a B positive.
Everybody should.
The blood of nomads.
Everybody should know their blood type. And if you don't know, you can simply walk in there and donate a pint. And of course, you'll get a small little workup, health workup. They take your blood pressure, your temperature. Mm-hmm. You check your iron, certainly. You have to have a certain threshold, meet a certain threshold to be able to donate. But they'll also give you your blood type when you get your results.
Let me say that 20 gallons, I imagine that in one...
160 pints,
yeah, that's
man.
A lot
that's
of blood.
That's more dramatic,
that's
right?
A lot of blood. But the other thing is, thank you, I want to say personally, thank you for bringing awareness to this subject. Thank you for your dedication to doing this, because this is something that's needed in the community, because blood is not yet manufactured, it is donated.
Thank you for saying so. And the other thing that was brought to my attention on Wednesday, which I had not really considered, because I was just focused on, you know, walking the walk and on the journey and one foot in front of the other. And, you know, 47 years later, here we are. But it, the blood, also the blood supply needs to be reflective of the diversity of the community. So as a Latino male, we are a wide array, the yes. colors of the rainbow. So it's important for us, all of us, to consider. Now, some can't do it because of physical limitations, we understand. But if you're well and if you're healthy, consider donating, because you don't ever know when you might need a pint of blood, or certainly somebody that you know and love. And the benefits of, I should say, the properties of O negative blood, for those that might not know, is that it's considered the universal donor. So you yes. come into the trauma center, somebody's in there, they need to save their life with a pint of blood immediately. The surgeon doesn't have time to test your blood and to type your blood. He's going to grab that bag of O-Neg and he's going to go to work.
Right.
So that's why it's important to do so. Well, thank you, Joe, for mentioning
sure,
that.
Sure, of course.
And to everybody at One Blood, thank you for making the day so special. There was cake. We had cake, Joseph.
And that yeah. made that glucose and
where
was, level.
Yeah, whoa, did it ever. Where did that cake come from? Wright's Gourmet Shop, right? Wright's Gourmet Deli right there in South Tampa. Hummingbird cake, for those of you that might know a little bit about
yes.
that.
All right.
Okay. Now we're off and running. Joey, who's our guest today?
Well, we have with us the primary facilitators and owners of the Commodore in Ybor City.
What is that Commodore, by the way?
And the Commodore is described, I think, loosely in the community as a comedy club.
Okay.
But I don't think that that's what it really is. I think it's more than a comedy club. And I've been there now a few times and been a patron of at some level, and I just think it's a marvelous place. So we have with us Justin Peters and Kelly Buttermore. And
not Butterless.
Not Butterless, and that's a great name, by the way. Butterless.
It is.
I'd love to have
I
the
love
name
it. I'm
Buttermore.
Going to ring a bell just for that.
And they're both here with us today.
Hey, Kelly. Hey, Justin.
Hey, friends.
Yep. Hi, Hello. Friends.
So speaking of the eclipse,
yes,
just
sir.
To go a brief
dark for a minute
into that. Yeah.
Unintended.
So one of our other partners who's not with us this morning, Kevin Mikulski, he saw this as a, and I'm sorry for stealing his story, but he's not with us. So he saw this as, you know, something he wanted to see. He wanted to, on short notice, he decided he wanted to see the eclipse. So he booked a flight to Ohio, drove to a small town right in the path of totality, sat in his hotel room, set his watch for when the
maximum viewing.
Yeah, the maximum viewing. And then about 40 minutes later, he sends us all a message, and he's like, well, I feel terrible because I missed the eclipse. I
slept through it?
He lost track of time.
He lost track of time.
Oh, my
God. Yeah, I'm sure it's...
Yikes.
It's a short window.
It is, and it only lasts for about 3 minutes because people don't realize...
Well, it lasts at various times, but... that one was very short. Some of them are a little longer, but still.
2045 is the next one, they say. And Florida, actually the Tampa Bay area, is in the path of totality.
Right.
And it's, you know, people don't realize it, but the sun is tracking through the sky at the same rate of speed all day long. From
yes.
the minute it breaks the horizon in the morning to the minute it sets in the west.
Yes.
And we don't notice it because the sky and the expanse of the sky is so vast that we don't have any reference points to see how fast it's going. But when you see the totality of an eclipse and you realize how it moves off, and nothing more than just when you're standing there on the shore and you're watching the sun set and you realize it hits the horizon. Look now, buddy, because you're gonna miss the green flash.
That's right.
Have you ever seen the green flash yet?
I have.
What?
Yes.
I thought I saw it once.
You thought you saw it?
I don't know. I wanted to see it so bad, I think I saw it.
I believe it's an
Justin,
optical.
Ever seen the green flash?
I have not.
Kelly?
I don't know what that is.
So at the moment that the sun sets, right,
okay.
at the moment that it drops just, I mean, literally when you see the last bit of the orb, that yellow orb, that magnificent yellow orb, there's supposed to be a moment of what people say is a green flash of light,
oh.
a green flash of light. Just, I mean, it's like brief, and sometimes you see, I don't think it's like the Aurora Borealis, though. That exists, and you see that all the time, right? The Northern Lights.
I really know nothing about this, but I will say this.
Attaboy, Joe.
I think that
I gave you a softball there. You could have just, you know, thrown it back.
No, I think that
Mario, they're beautiful. I've seen it on TV.
I believe the green flash is an optical effect that has to do with pigmentation and saturation
of light
and your eyes. And I think that the green light is because of the color that at that little moment something shifts and you see something that's either there or not there. I don't know.
Let me give the phone number out today, and let me give the email and the text number out so that people can call us and join the conversation and maybe clarify some of this business about the green flash.
There you go.
Or if it's, you know, maybe it's not a, it's maybe it's a Marvel hero. It's a new one, though. It's the green flash. It's not just a regular flash. If you'd like to join the conversation this morning, please call us at 813-239-9663. Email DJ at WMNF.org. And you can always text us, 813-433-0885. And isn't the Commodore just a grand, magnificent community space?
It is something that I've really come to kind of fall in love with for the brief moment I've been there.
In great part because of these two people sitting in front of us today. Justin, yeah, how did this whole odyssey begin?
It has been an odyssey.
Is that the apt term?
That's the apt term. That's the one I would use.
Because words matter.
They do matter.
Justin, and you are a wordsmith. We'll talk about that in a minute.
You know, you got to be able to speak your mission into being, because if you can't tell your own story, ain't no one else going to tell it for you. And we founded an improv comedy festival here in Ybor City in 2017. Our background is we're touring comedians. We're, you know, been based in New York for a long time, started coming down to Tampa, putting on shows here, and sort of fell in love with the city and the Ybor City neighborhood. And the festival, it still goes on. It happens every August, but after a certain amount of time, it became clear that there's a lot of funny, creative people in Tampa, in St. Petersburg, in the area, who really needed and wanted a standalone space.
Where to express their talents.
To express their talents. And we were like, well, good luck, guys. This is not our cross to bear. And then it turned out it was when we were driving down.
He said, well, you know, the real story isn't what I'm doing here. I said, what's that? He said, the real story is Zion.
That was a news clip from Paul Guzzo a few shows back. Please continue.
Paul Guzzo was with us last...
two shows ago, yeah. He was the Salute and Happy Days guest of honor. So maybe Paul's thinking about us right now, and he'll be giving us a call shortly.
He just gave us a little green flash from...
Dale, Paul.
But Kel can pick it up from here, right?
So it was your cross to bear, Kel? Did you see it coming? Could you sense it was on the way?
You know, it's hard to say. I mean... So running the festival also, so it's not just the creative people that were around us, but we got to see the ways in which Tampa and Ybor and the community and the city was changing and growing
and
over
rapidly,
time.
You know?
And so, you know, we had this hunch in the back of our minds that there would be a lot of people in this city that would love to see the sort of work that we put on a regular basis if they only had a place to see it. Mm-hmm. And so... through some sort of serendipity, I don't know. We were on one of our endless quests to get the perfect lunch, and we drove down 7th past Nebraska, and we saw a for rent sign in a window at 811 East 7th, and we were like, "Yeah, let's give it a call." We kind of casually started looking at places, and then it just, you know, everything kind of came together. It came together a lot more quickly than I think we were planning on, to be honest.
Oh yeah, there was definitely a moment where we were all like, well, just so we're all clear, none of us know what we're doing.
Yeah, did you find yourself breathing into a paper bag shortly thereafter, trying to calm down?
Yeah, I mean, it's, none of us had ever, you know, we'd all, because there's five of us in the ownership group, and we'd all produced, you know, a lot of stuff. We have a ton of experience, but none of us have ever run a standalone, permanent, regular venue before. And so we, in a very improv mindset, and maybe you shouldn't apply improv to business, we're still figuring that out, but we leapt a bit before we looked. And we knew that we were not going to find a space that checked so many boxes, just in terms logistically, creatively. Like, we were in there, and, you know, the space just has good bones, you know? And it has a lot of history to it. And so, and we also have great neighbors on that block. So that that area of Greater Ybor. So
ample parking in the area.
Ample parking.
Easy accessibility. You're not quite into the depths of 7th Avenue, so you're on the periphery, but you're certainly close enough. And so this Manifest Destiny, all of a sudden, you know, you wished it into existence, and here we are. And how long has the facility been open now, and how long have you been putting on shows?
We have, we had our soft open, so we called it, in mid-November. So we're really still young.
Babies,
young,
yeah.
Still a baby theater, yeah.
We're in our rookie season.
Yeah, we sure are. So we do shows a couple nights a week, and we're looking to expand that.
But you're gaining momentum, because each and every time that you have a show, and some of them are very Tampa-centric, we'll get into that, you get more and more people that come out. And it's, again, it's very convenient. It's very easy in, easy out, easy access. So tell us, let's let everybody know the history from whence you came. So, Justin, born, raised, and what was your principal occupation before you decided to become a performer?
Before I lost my mind.
Well, then, of course.
I grew up in the Chicago area, moved to New York State after college.
Big shoulders.
Yeah,
big shoulders.
Exactly. The city of big shoulders, then the Big Apple. I like cities with the word big in them.
There you go. Some will call this area the Big Guava. I don't know, Joe, does that still go? Is that still a thing?
I like it, personally.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll take it.
I like
it.
Guava.
You know,
I like guava.
Comedy loves a pattern, so the Big Guava is the third in the pattern. I've been a writer and a journalist for about 20 years. Improv and comedy club management, at least to this point, are not particularly lucrative. It is a labor of love, so I underwrite that labor of love with labors of labor, as we all do.
And we pass the hat. Yes, we do.
That's right. But yeah, Kelly and I have been performing together as a comedy duo since 2010. We've done hundreds of shows all over the country on the road, performing and teaching at clubs and festivals here, there, and everywhere. We did a cruise once, which was very confusing for everyone, including the people who were on the cruise and didn't understand what we were doing, telling jokes on what they thought was a karaoke stage. And, you know, life brought us here. Life eventually brought us here, and it's here, I think, because this is both a community that didn't have this space, mm-hmm, and also deserves this space, mm-hmm, because the more you live in Tampa, if you've got your eyes open and your ears to the ground, the more you learn just what an interesting city this is, with interesting people from all walks of life, every one of whom has a story, every one of whom will sit and bend your ear with it for 20 minutes if you're not careful. And, you know, as the mission of the Commodore has, you know, solidified, it has really become a place for those stories. We call it community placemaking, comedic placemaking, right? Where we use the tools of comedy in conjunction with the stories and life experiences of the people who live here in order to create this sort of art form that's both funny and also roots everyone who comes to see it in the place where we all live as something that could only exist in this city, in this space, at this point in time.
And we are grateful for that. Kelly, give us a little bit of your background and your history.
Sure. So I am from Mystic, Connecticut. Is that a reference that carries all the way down to Tampa?
I love that city name.
It is, yeah. The movie Mystic Pizza.
There you go.
Was filmed there, and the, you know, restaurant's still there. But yeah, it's a beautiful place to grow up in New England. Went to Mount Holyoke College, shout mm-hmm. out, mm-hmm. in South Hadley, Massachusetts. Had a great experience there, and then moved to New York to pursue improv, in spite of the fact that I had only seen it and never done it, which occurs to me as a very 22-year-old thing to do. So thank you to that past version of me for taking a shot on that.
Right.
Yeah, and as Justin said, we have a lot of labors of love, so, and I also underwrite my labor of love with a labor of labor. So I for the last 20 years, have worked in the academic nonprofit space.
You don't often get an opportunity to see something like this come to fruition, and especially if you've not been exposed to it before, and then all of a sudden, you know, it touches you somewhere profoundly where all, you know, your journey might, you know, you get off at that exit ramp and you go down that street to find that neighborhood to see what's going on. Kelly, please continue. I cut you off. I'm sorry.
No. I mean, it's so interesting. Like, I have a vivid memory of the first improv show I ever saw. And I had that, call it a green flash, if you will. But
it's the theme today.
It's the theme today. But I had this moment. There's something about the spontaneous creativity of improv and the connection between the people on stage. And you see it and you're like, I want to do that. I want to learn how to do that. And it's really unlike any other art form, because I'll tell you, I've been to plenty of concerts and I don't think, you know, I'm going to go start a band or something. No, you know, like there's a level of accessibility mm-hmm. to this art form. You do not need, you know, special training, special equipment. You need to bring your honesty and your vulnerability and your truth to, you bring yourself to improv, and that's all you need to bring, and a willingness to say yes to your partner and to build things together. And so it's really remarkable how those experiences can be so formative. And I think it's so hard too, because we talk about this all the time, but you know, I will also say that improv's not always good either. And so I think...
Well, we hear that from the MC. We hear that from the MC when the lights come down.
Yep.
The MC jumps out on stage as energetic as he is, and he's leading us through and he's giving us kind of our, you know, what right. you're about to see.
Right.
He tells you, this is, you know, we're going to create this together. We're going to create this in real time. It's going to happen right in front of you.
You know what? Let me just say, let's take just a moment and realize that Kelly has been drinking from the well of profundity. That is what she just said in those last 8 or 9 sentences was
pretty amazing.
Really amazing, yeah. And it really brought it all together, and it actually gave me a little moment of insight that I even haven't had yet about all of this, and it is that I think my part of my connection to feeling good about what they're doing in Ybor City, technically,
of all places,
which gets a lot of criticism because people don't like change in Ybor.
Correct.
They want it to always remain the way it used to be. And we are now having a lot of changes in Ybor City, and the Commodore is one of the most positive. And I think my connection is that I've always been a community person. I believe that everything that needs to happen in the world happens at the community level.
100%.
We can all sit here and wring our hands about the global scene right now and warfare and how bad it might be, but it's what you do in your neighborhood with your people and your tribe that changes everything. And in fact, our master board op Skip and I were having a conversation about this earlier before the show, and that is where the contribution can be made. And I didn't come to that easily. I came to that accidentally when I moved to Ybor City and started doing my work there. So what they're doing and what she's talking about, I think, is what has turned me on, because I realize for people to get on a stage, I was in theater in college, mm-hmm. and it's different to be on stage with a script and a part where everything is structured.
Yeah, choreographed.
These are people that are getting up there and they're going to hope that they hit some gold, but they might hit a lot of dirt. And
But everybody's got a pickaxe, but you know, everybody's contributing.
Is? Yeah, but exactly, Mario. And so what that really is it's vulnerability.
Mm-hmm.
And when they expose themselves vulnerably, they are connecting to the community. And that's a great place to be.
May I add to that just
Please.
Quickly? And thank you for saying all that. I think the only... that's exactly right. And I think one of the wonderful things about improv as an art form, you know, that you practice is that it levels the playing field. So everybody's contribution is valued equally. There's no hierarchy in improv. We're all coming to this together and we're all agreeing, you know, we're all on the same level. So in terms of a community space, I mean, improv is obviously better for a diversity of perspectives, and I think we all agree with that, but I think I just want to say that it really has the effect of making everybody's contributions equally valued, which I really like.
There's not the star of the show.
No.
Very
no.
Very democratic process. Yeah. Very yeah. democratic process, yes. Small d
and
democratic process.
Yes.
No, and you know, tonight is going to be a very special show because, Joe, you're going to be the featured guest. But before we kind of delve into that, at the bottom of the hour, let me remind everybody. And Mike, we saw you calling from Sarasota. I was just about to go to you, and you dropped off the line. But we are getting emails. I want to read a couple of them real quick because apparently we touched a nerve with the green flash conversation. And I think everybody thought we were going to just, like, the whole show was going to be about the green flash. But what a fun topic. The green flash is from the light refraction through the water, in our case, the Gulf of Mexico, after the sun has gone past the horizon. You only see it on days where there's little atmospheric interference and really calm waters. And so I'm going to talk to somebody in the studio about increasing the font size on this thing because it's really hard to read from a distance. But yes, so the green flash is real, but it only happens during certain days, kind of like the Northern Lights, right? You have to have certain conditions available for it to actually be present. So if you'd like to call us again, let me remind you that number, 813-239-9663. DJ@WMNF.org if you'd like to send us an email, which I'm reading. 813-433-0885 if you'd like to send us a text. So this we should kind of bring up now improvisational theater. There are different styles, different formats. We're all familiar with the show on TV that was very popular that I've forgotten the name of already. It's so popular. Wait, don't tell me. No, that's not the show. That's on NPR on Saturdays. But the style, the brand of improvisational comedy that you guys employ here on these wonderful evenings is called the Armando Method, and it's a little bit different. Am I right about that?
Yeah, that's right. So unlike what you'd see on Whose Line Is It Anyway?
Thank you.
You're welcome.
That's the show.
That's the show.
Thank you.
I got a bell. I got the ding.
Yes, you did.
Those are sort of snappy, quick-witted, game-based, sort of in competition with each other, and that's fun to watch, and that's really well suited for television. We create comedic theater based on stories that guests tell on our stage.
Ah, it's a little different.
It's a little bit different. It's a little bit less linear, less competitive. It exists in the space of dream logic, right? Like, our performers will take elements of the stories, the true life stories that our monologists tell on stage, and sort of mash them together in a way that your brain does when you're sleeping. And it might not make linear sense, the comedic scenes we see from there, but it all sort of hangs together in the world that everyone is sharing during the show, which is sort of fun.
It's brilliant. It's brilliant. And if you've never been in the theater, it's an intimate theater. The space is very small. I don't say very small. It's small. Not very small. It's small. So that you are sitting within a close proximity to the actors and you get a chance to see it all come. It's like, Joey, it's like you're cooking from scratch. You know, they say, cooking from scratch. You got nothing. And now you're going to create something beautiful right in real time. And the interesting part is, and this has been the experience, my takeaway, Justin, for the times that I've been there, which is many now, I'm earning my jacket, I'm earning my stripes, is that you watch the comedic actors work, and they will take, of course, they take from the stories that the monologists offer, and they'll take the best parts and they'll fashion that into some kind of a improvisational comedic routine right in front of your eyes. But then it always has the magic ability to take the parts that happen in the front of the show and circle back around, and you'll see some of that being sprinkled back into the back end of the show. So there is continuity. It's not just all ad hoc and willy-nilly.
Yeah,
there is building and the continuity.
There's a feeding that's happening, and there's a reciprocal feeding that I see that it's really exciting. That's what makes it dynamic. And you were talking about the theater being small. Let's call it intimate.
I like
it's
that
not,
better.
It's not it, what also works rather than Kelly and Justin planned it and their partners or not, is that it's not the Straz Theater. You know, it's not this big place. It is it's this place where you come and you sit and it has a living room
love it
feeling.
Yes, it does.
And you're there and you're watching this and it's intimate. And I think that's part of the effect. And of course, as they're saying, if you're doing spontaneous thought processing and creativity, it might work and it might quite not work.
And that's the exciting part, because we live in a society now where everything around us in our media is all seamed up and sealed and made perfect and made clean and made into a product. There is no product here. This is just people who are interacting, and it might work and it might not. And you know what? It's exciting to see it when it doesn't work as much as it does when it does work.
Of course. And to watch the actors recover from it. And again, we'd like to talk about the Armando Method, because if those people come out tonight to watch the show, which you will be featured, Salute and Happy Days, again, Tampa-centric, all Tampa stories, they might not understand exactly what they're seeing. So we're going to get into the structure of the Armando Method in just a moment. But we do have a caller that I'd like to acknowledge, because he's been waiting for a few minutes. Christopher from Tampa, you're on the air. Tell us what you're thinking today.
Hey, good morning, guys. I just got back into town. I live in Baja, California, which is about an hour south of San Diego.
A billion miles from us. Go ahead. We hear you.
Yeah. Well, you guys were talking about the Green Flash, and I have an intimate experience with the Green Flash, because at my place in Baja, I have a telescope set up. So I actually have the telescope trained on the sunset every single day. And when you have the telescope on the sunset, as a Florida boy, I'm born and raised in Tampa.
Attaboy.
For a long time. But, you know, I always thought the Green Flash was like this strange phenomenon. Like it was going to be some strobe effect where you're just like, I just never understood it. Like, what is it? Just like a pop? And it wasn't until I had the telescope trained on the sun that I realized when you watch the sun go down in a telescope, that last half second, you get this pop of green. And it's very hard to see with the naked eye, typically. And you're right, it does have to be a very clear sky in order to see it. But with a telescope or binoculars, it's very, very easy to see on a clear day. And I'm just so surprised. I never knew you could see it over the Gulf. This is all news to me. I thought it was a Pacific phenomenon, that you had to have a body of, you know, an ocean. But now you're saying you can see it here in St. Pete, Tampa?
We can, but I think, like as you're alluding to, the atmospheric conditions have to be precise. And I'm guessing that the best chance to catch a green flash here would be during those winter months when the dew points are very low, the humidity is super low, the sky is real clear, and then you can catch it. Because with the summer, you know, that summer ick,
that haze,
mm-hmm. you just lose it. It gets buried. But listen, right. Where did you go to high school here, Christopher?
I went to high school. First, I went to Jesuit, and luckily got kicked out of Jesuit my junior year, and then I ended up at King High School.
Attaboy, King Lion's in the house today. Hey, Christopher, thank you so much for listening.
Thank you
And you're in Baja presently? Is that correct?
No, I came home to visit my mom for a month. So I'm really excited to hear about this new improv comedy troupe you guys got going on.
Man, you should come out and try to join us tonight. We'd love to meet you.
What time does it start?
7 p.m. Doors open, and again, Joe was alluding to the fact that it feels like your neighbor's living room, and it really, really does. And kudos to the people that brought the furniture in, because they actually have couches. It's fabulous.
Can you buy tickets, or do you get them at the door?
Right there at the door.
It'll sell out, like, before you get there.
He can buy in advance at their website.
That's correct, and we'll give that information out. So please keep listening, and welcome home, my brother.
Thanks so much, guys. Keep up the good work.
Thank you. So there you go. Huh? The Green Flash. We're going to have to make comments about the Green Flash tonight. Work it into the routine.
The people have spoken.
Yes, they have.
That's right.
Yes, they have.
Yeah.
So tell us about the Armando Method and what's so unique about it.
And one more thing before you do. Also, let's make sure we cover the fact that you provide classes.
Yeah.
And this gives an opportunity for people who have never done this to do it.
We're just wrapping up right now a class all on the Armando Method, which we might offer again. But Kelly can, you know, talk about this probably better than I can. But our friend Armando Diaz, who is, you know, one of the, you know, better known improv minds in the United States. In the 90s, he was in Chicago at Improv Olympic there. And they created a show around him because, you know, he's sort of an interesting guy with a lot of stories. Armando would stand on stage and just tell true stories from his life. And then a troupe of about, you know, six or eight people, a lot of whom have gone on to, you know, very prominent careers in the entertainment
industry. This was 30 years ago.
Yeah,
sure.
30 years ago, yeah.
In Chicago.
In Chicago, yeah.
Second
sort
city.
Of, the, you know, fountainhead for a lot of this comedic work. You know, they would riff off of the stories that Armando told, and when they ran out of gas, he'd come back on stage and tell another
Reset.
Story. Yeah, and then the second round of riffing would, as Joe was saying, pull in some stuff from the first round, and everything starts to tie together. And from there, the method has spread, and, you know, a lot of theaters around the country do it. But I think Kelly would agree that, you know, few of them are doing it in the way that we're doing it here at the Commodore.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, so traditionally how it can be done a number of ways, but it often is a fellow improviser from the troupe telling stories, which is great. That's fine. You know, everybody has a story to tell, but we, you know, we really have made it part of our mission to bring the stories of Tampa. You know, we don't want you to walk into the Commodore and think I could be anywhere. Right? I mean, the whole point, if you're going to undertake something, a project of this magnitude, let's make it rooted in the place where it's
happening.
And so, you know, it really, and to be honest, it's a bit of a marketing thing too, I won't lie, right? So like, you get somebody in there who's never done anything like this before. They bring people that their friends and family to come support them. And that exposes more people to the art form of improv. It's good for everybody. And so it kind of has that side benefit too. But the goal of the improv portion is not necessarily to restate the monologue or, like, you know, play out the story as it was told, but to use it as inspiration, you know, sort of deconstruct it,
yeah,
as it were.
We love creating moments of non-linearity, yeah, with our space, right? You know, Joe, you were saying something, you know, that, you know, is so true, that the best part of any given show at the Commodore is when it doesn't work. And I really mean this, you know, like, because that illuminates that the process is the product, right? Watching people on stage under hot lights trying to face the pressures that we all face in our daily lives 100 times. We got to rise to the moment, have the exact right thing to say at the exact right time. But in the theater, people are watching you and it's supposed to be funny. When it doesn't work, it's relatable. And you know what? When you see the performers trying to recover from that and bring things back, it all situates us in the moment that we're all sharing, which is so rare.
It's very human. It's very human. It's very connected. And I don't want anybody to think that when a line or two might fall flat, that you hear something in the background that comes out, dun, dun, da,
dun.
You know, no, there's none of that.
Right.
They just recover. They go on.
No laugh track.
And no laugh track whatsoever. And let me share with my dear friend Justin Peters, who is a baseball fan as I am. Buddy, 300 will get you to the Hall of Fame.
That's right.
That means you're successful 3 out of 10 times. What's happening the other 7 times? Those jokes are falling a little flat. But when they hit, aren't they sweet?
Right.
Aren't they? And when you hit it well and you hear that sound off the bat, it's like when the line is coming out of your mouth and you immediately get the reaction from the crowd. It's like, oh, we're making magic now.
Oh, yeah. Look, if you hit 300, you're getting a $10 million contract after you reach free agency.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
By the way,
great analogy.
I think that, in a way, the Commodore has the potential to become more successful than they might even want it to be, because I think that's what's happening is that kind of human interaction and getting to see something that's not scripted, that anything could happen. Where do you go to see that in your life? What performance do you go to see that? I mean, if you go to a concert, those guys are all on top of their game and they've practiced and, you know, whatever.
And they're sitting on an elevated stage and way from
you. I mean, you might in some little tavern see some live music that's something's not working right. But generally speaking, life is a series of incredible moments and train wrecks. That's what our lives are. And this is what they're offering you. And it's a really a wonderful thing, I think.
Thank you so much. And I want to also say, you know, the moment that we are in, and something that came to our minds when we decided to do this in the first place, is that we you know, in the height of the pandemic was a moment of isolation and disconnection. And I think, you know, other ways of connecting virtually, obviously, but we've just all gone through something that took us away from each other. And this is bringing us back to communication and connection and,
yeah,
and that face-to-face yes. thing at a moment that, that I think is, I personally think is really important. Yeah, that's,
yeah, you know, I agree. I agree. Yeah. And I also,
here, can I ring a bell for that?
Yeah. And I also think in my personal cosmology, which I have many, but one is storytelling. I've evolved into a storyteller.
You raconteur, you.
Yeah, right. I've evolved into that, but I've always done it. But the point is now I actually get paid sometimes to do it. And either as a writer or as a person.
Bonus.
Yeah, whatever. So I think that that is the chief function of humanity is storytelling. I think I think science is storytelling. Einstein told this great story. It's called energy equals mass twice the speed of light. You know, I mean, that's what is happening. So every time you see somebody like Michio Kaku on a feed somewhere talking about quantum physics, he's telling a story. We are storytellers. Humans are technologists and storytellers. That's what we are. That's our whole gig. And if there are billions of planets out there in the universe with civilizations, we're probably known as the storytellers. That's probably how they all see us. You know, those are the storytellers down on that planet. I think that that's what's really important. What's happening here is that somebody gets to tell a story, and then somebody gets to reinterpret it, and it changes the whole nature of that story. So that now you are seeing where the little runoffs are, and extra dimensions, you know, multi-dimensional. So it's really a very cool experience. I highly recommend it to anyone to come on down and check it out.
And you can join us this evening again. Doors open at 7:00. I think we've done a magnificent job of letting everybody know what they could be in for tonight. No pressure, y'all. No pressure, because there's no... I mean, listen, they don't feel the pressure anyway. Yeah, you understand what I'm saying?
Thanks, Mario.
They don't feel the pressure anyway. So you know, with about 10, 12 minutes, maybe a little bit more than that left in show, Justin, you mentioned, and of course Kelly did as well, that you guys are grounding this in Tampa lore, in Tampa history. You've had some featured guests on the show, and this Salute and Happy Days thematic part of it, because there are other shows, but this one in particular, the Salute and Happy Days, is Tampa centric. Where did that come about, and explain a little bit about the genesis of that?
We were having a drink with our friend Keith Arsenault in the middle of 2023. We just signed a lease on the place. We were trying to come up with what the programming was going to be. And, you know, Keith, who, you know, he should be a guest on this show one of these days.
And we're working on
I'm
it,
sure
Keith.
He will.
We're working on it.
He started telling the story of Andy Hardy and Manuel Barro and the Valencia Gardens restaurant.
There you go.
And the Salute and Happy Days catchphrase, and how, you know, the various theories about...
what were they doing with the numbers?
What were they doing with the numbers?
Right.
And we were like, this is the most Tampa story we've ever heard. Like, this should, if there's an encyclopedia definition of Tampa, that should be the story. So we walked away and we're like, you know what we should do when we open? We should have an Armando-style show with people who know a lot about Tampa telling stories about it. And we should call the show Salute and Happy Days.
Man after my own heart right there.
Yeah, that's good stuff.
When I heard that phrase, of course, I leaned into it. I'm thinking, oh my goodness, what is happening here? And then getting to meet Justin and getting to meet Kelly, it just all went full circle. And you've had some fabulous Tampa, people of note, right? So Paul Guzzo, we mentioned him a little bit earlier. The crew that wrote the book on the history of the Cuban sandwich, including Andy Hughes. I was the inaugural. I was the Chuck Yeager. Is it safe to say I was the Chuck Yeager of the Salute and Happy Days? Because I was, when they strapped me into the, they said, Marty, we want you to come on and we want you to be our monologist for the evening, and we're going to do this. And I'm going to say, I don't know how this is going to work, but of course I'm going to do this. I'm all for it. And we had a wonderful time, and we sat down together, you and I, and you interviewed me.
Your parents were there?
It was, my mom and dad were there that night.
It was amazing.
It was pretty cool. It was pretty cool. So we're, you're in for a treat. If you decide to come out tonight, you're in for a special treat. And Joe Howden will be, I think, the fourth or fifth or sixth in line of Tampaños that is going to be interviewed and tell his story. And this cat here has some stories. I'm just going to say. He might not be able to tell all of them because, you know, we've had children in the audience, correct?
Yeah,
even though it's
right.
An adult-centric, no, you know, sometimes.
I understand that it's going to have to be G-rated, but.
On the other hand,
PG-13.
Yeah, PG-13.
PG-13. You know, there we go.
Like the first Green Flash movie, right?
There it is. There it is.
The Green Flash.
But no, I think Joe, like within 10 minutes of the first time I'd met you, I think I was telling you we have to get you on this.
Yes,
stage.
Yes. And actually, I didn't move more quickly because I don't jump. I test the water and then I think about it. So I'm excited about being there.
It's your time, baby. It's your time tonight. So we got an email. I want to read this real quick. It says, I am B+ and a platelet donor for the record. I've seen the Green Flash several times here. Green Flash. Several times here. The weather has to be completely clear. No cloud cover at all. Always varies in size and intensity. Couldn't hold any longer. This is from Wendy. She was holding on the phone. But thank you, Wendy. I hope that I did you proud by reading your message. I for one am looking forward to tonight's show and maybe meet there a little bit early and grab a bite next door at the restaurant that's right around the corner because they're open until 8 o'clock, I think, this
mm-hmm.
evening.
Mm-hmm.
Can we give them a plug too?
Sure.
What's the name of that restaurant, Joe?
The Flan Factory.
Oh, the Flan Factory.
Yeah, it's very good.
The Flan Factory.
It's really good.
Oh, it's really good. It's so good that we're whispering it, you know, because we don't want anybody else to go there.
They did receive Creative Loafing's vote for best Cuban sandwich in Tampa.
And that's an art form as much as the Armando method of improvisational
Absolutely.
Comedy is. You know, I mean, everybody puts their little touch on that Cuban sandwich to make
it's
it special.
Yeah.
The frame should always be La Segunda Bread. I think we can all agree that that's probably where you start.
Right.
Okay, we're going to use, everybody's going to use the same wood to build the house. Now, what you put on the inside of the house, that's your business.
Yeah, they're very good.
Huh?
That's right.
I see my buddy Justin over there laughing because he knows I would be a good improvisational actor too. Right, Justin?
Oh, that's right.
Oh, yeah.
Yum. I got to get over there, man. If I gotta
Take
squeeze
a
out,
class.
I'm going to squeeze out some time. Yes, I am.
Yeah.
Yes,
Take
I
a
am.
Class.
So, Joe,
yes.
How do you feel at this moment about being honored like you're going to be honored tonight?
Well, the only thing I can say about this is I just have to trust Justin implicitly to guide me as he does the interview and make sure that he doesn't let me take over. And
be careful what you wish for, Justin. Kelly,
yeah,
he's worse than me. You give him a mic, all bets are off.
Well, you know, like I said, storytelling. In my family, storytelling was the rite of passage. As a child became an adult, if you could tell a story and get your relatives to listen to you, you would become an adult. And it probably goes back to some North European tradition. I don't know, Irish, Scottish. But at any rate, that's just the way it was. And so I've always been telling stories, and I function as a lay resident historian in Ybor City. And now I new guests who come to Ybor City every day walk around with me, and I tell them stories, and they are amazed by the great story of Ybor City and what it means to the world, and I love sharing it. And so I'm a very lucky man that I get to be that person that gets to tell stories and people want to actually give me their attention for a few minutes.
I want to read this email because especially for you, Kelly, it says, I am enjoying your Friday AM show as usual, and I recently joined the WMNF Circle of Friends. Thank you for that. I heard your guest mention that she attended Mount Holyoke College in Western Mass. It was a beautiful campus and had an excellent theater department. I graduated from Mount Holyoke in 1976. Thank you. She remained anonymous, but she knows who she is if she's still listening. And I had an idea that I was. What were you talking about, Joey, just a second ago before I jumped in?
Ybor City?
Oh, yes. Thank you so much. Ding. I'm right back to where I need to be. And this is how it works, baby. Give myself a bell. Talk a little bit in the couple of minutes that we have left, the connection between the space, the Commodore, and the mutual aid clubhouses.
Something I feel strongly about is of the great story of Ybor City, and earlier Justin was talking about the stories of Tampa, and a lot of that has to do with Ybor City becoming really the most ethnically diverse city in the South next to New Orleans because of the cigar industry, that the two big things in that story that really stand out is the story of the lector, El Lector, who read to the workers, and also the mutual aid societies, the social clubs. And those social clubs were really the glue that bound together that entire society. And for some reason, I connect the Commodore with the way those social clubs functioned, because they're very different, very, very different, but except for one thing. I see that the Commodore is a place where community can come together, and that's what was important about the mutual aid societies of Ybor City in the early days, because they had developed this program in Cuba because the king wasn't always on top of his game, and the people needed to support each other. So they supported each other through a system called mutual aid, and it touches, for some people, uncomfortably on socialism. But the point is, it is a system by which these people helped each other. And it reminds me a little bit of what I see happening, because I think, as we've already covered here, the Commodore has a feeling it's a kind of a democratic process when you don't have a star of the show. I think that and there's a connection there for me. So I see this as being kind of connected to our history.
And I'm assuming, much like the Pirates of the Caribbean movies and pirates in general, if you're not a good steward, if you're not a good captain of the ship per se, you're walking the plank, buddy. Because you know what I'm saying? We ain't having none of that. Well, and nobody better to guide us through an evening's performance than the master of ceremonies, Justin Peters. Because when he jumps out on stage,
yes,
his hair is a mess. He's half sweaty because he's been doing everything backstage. And, you know, he's ready, though.
Yeah.
He's revved up and ready. He's loose. He's been stretching backstage. Before we get out of here, Justin, is there anything you'd like people to know about tonight's performance, or you want to give an invitation? Certainly would love to have that.
Yeah.
Give us the particulars.
So doors open at 7 tonight at the Commodore. It's 811 East 7th Avenue, right off of Nebraska.
Just east. That corner of Nebraska and 7th. It's northeast corner of Nebraska and 7th.
That's right.
No, not northeast. My geography is off. Southwest, because if you think of it, it's right there. The white building, you can't miss it, Tampeños.
It's the only building on those four corners.
Yeah. You can't miss it.
Yeah, you can't miss it. Lots of parking. You can go to our website. Can I say that on the air?
Please do.
CommodoreComedy.com if you want to purchase in advance, but we have tickets for sale at the door. It's a lot of fun. It's probably unlike anything else that you've ever seen. You could sit at home and watch Netflix, or, you know, stare at each other, or you can come out and, you know, be a Tampeño.
That's no fun, by the way.
That's boring.
Join the Tampeños tonight in theater. Kelly, please give us some closing comments.
Thank you so much for having us. It's such a joy to get to talk about why we do this and what it means, you know, and I think I agree. You know, we all have a story to tell, and we're just grateful to be providing a platform for these stories. As Joe alluded to earlier, we have classes as well. And people want to give this a shot, we have a drop-in class every Thursday that you could just literally drop in and try improv.
Come stretch a different muscle.
Yeah.
I love that. Yeah. Come stretch a different muscle. Yeah. Let's put that on the next T-shirt,
y'all. Yeah, I love that.
Joey, what did you do?
Don't copyright that.
come out tonight and encourage all the actors, and certainly participate, contribute. We have snacks. We have merch. I mean, it's just like a regular little thing that happens all the time right there in Ybor. Joey, quick, give me a quick closing comment.
This has been a joy, and I love being with these people, and I'm looking forward to
two of the kindest, most nicest people that you will ever meet, Justin Peters and Kelly Buttermore. Thank you so much for being here, okay? For everybody that's listened today to our show with love in their heart, and we know you're out there, thank you for listening. Thank you for calling in your emails. Thanks, Skip, for working the board. Irene, for answering our calls. You've been listening to Down and Dirty. I'm Mario Nunez. My co-host today has been Joe Howden. Have a great weekend, everybody. Mm-hmm.
So sorry.
This is WMNF Tampa.